ask me what the scariest moment of my life was, I would have to say that there were two. The first one being our small boat flying off the top of a 30-foot wave and slamming down into the trough, shaking and shuddering as we battled the worst storm of our lives in the middle of the Red Sea. The wind was terrifying. It had been blowing at more than 55 knots for more than 24 hours and had built the seas up to enormous size. In addition to being huge, they were steep and they were coming fast. I remember counting 1,001, 1,002, 1,003, and bam, there was another one that would hit us. We were exhausted. We'd been up for more than 24 hours and I was starting to hallucinate. I looked over at my crew, Ken and CJ, and I saw that their eyes were as wide as saucers and they were pretty scared, as was I. But I didn't really have much choice. You know, when you fear is a funny thing, it offers you two choices, fight or flight. And there weren't many flights going out of the middle of the Red Sea that morning. So I didn't have much choice but to stay and fight to survive. We all have this ability inside of us. I didn't even know I had it, though. I didn't know about the ability to dig deep for a strength that I didn't even know existed. But we all have it. The trick is just to try to dig for it before we actually need it. Well, that morning in the Red Sea paled in comparison to the fear that I experienced on another cold, crisp morning of December 7th, 2001, when we sailed out the Golden Gate and turned south and headed for I didn't really know where. I was leaving everything. I had a very secure life in the corporate world, but I needed to get out. I wanted to get out. And I was leaving my job, my income, my career, my friends, my family, and the security of my life. But I was willing to do it. I was willing to risk everything. Now, about a year before that, I wasn't really sure, and so I asked a friend of mine, Bob, I asked his father, Al. And Al, at the time, was dying of cancer. He was in the hospital, and he was in his hospital bed. And I went up to him, and I said, Al, look what I'm about to do. I'm about to give up everything. Everything I've worked for 20 years. I'm giving up my home, my job, my security. Should I be doing this? And he was pale and white and weak, and he leaned up off the bed, grabbed my hand, and pulled me down to him, and he nearly shouted in my ear, go, man, go! And so I did. And it was a good advice. You know, the decision to go was kind of a mixture of excitement and cold feet. And you just have to decide, though. After I didn't have any more information, I had to make that decision. So it's almost like ordering off the menu when the waiter comes around and says, well, what'll you have? You made that decision. You have to make that decision. And when you step off the curb to cross the street, there's that one final decision that you're making to step off the curb. This decision was just a little bit bigger, but it's the same idea. But you know, these scary times that I'm talking to you about were also the happiest moments of my life. I was alive. The fear clarified everything for me, and it sharpened my senses. Sometimes we just have to choose to do the scary thing. Right? I will admit there was a third scary moment, and that was the morning that I sat down with my mother, my Jewish mother, Julia, and I said, Mom, I'm quitting my job to go sailing. I tried to soften the blow by naming the boat after her, Julia. So how did all this start? This crazy idea start? Well, it all started with a dream, and then I turned that dream into a goal. I've been dreaming about sailing around the world since I was 13. And here you can see a photo of me in Alamitos Bay, just up in Long Beach. This is in 1969. Now, if anybody here is a friend of Larry Ellison with the America's Cup, I want you to know that this is a prelude to me being a skipper on the new America's Cup catamaran. I used to ride my bike down to the marina and go sailing after school. Some kids went surfing, I went sailing. And after I put my boat away, my Hobie Cat, I would ride my bike over to where the big boats were docked. And I would stand at the gates, and they were always locked because they were the big boats. And I just stood there as a kid, and I just stared, and I imagined what it would be like to be on my own boat and to be able to back out of the slip and head up the channel and turn south. You know, that dream turned full circle, because when we sailed out the Golden Gate Bridge and turned south, our second port of call was Long Beach. And when we pulled into Long Beach, we pulled up to the Long Beach Yacht Club. We tied up, we had a cocktail in hand, and all of a sudden I had a revelation, and I realized that we were docked at the exact same dock that I used to stand behind the gate when I was a kid so many years earlier. So dreams can come true. About several years later, when we were halfway around the world, we were in Tel Aviv. And same thing, we were sitting inside of a locked gate, and I remember looking up and seeing a kid standing at the gate. He was about 10 years old, and he had short, curly black hair, and he was just staring at us. And he was staring at me, he was staring at the boat, and he was staring at the lifestyle and what we were doing. And I realized that I was looking at myself. And it was an amazing revelation to realize, and it made me truly believe that you can make your dreams come true. Now, one of the things that I did is I wrote my goals down. I don't know why it works, but I still have the piece of paper that I wrote in 1991, 10 years before we sailed out the Golden Gate. I wrote down, own a 50-foot sailboat and cruise the South Pacific. 10 years later, we sailed out the Golden Gate Bridge. So if you leave here with nothing else, leave here with the idea that whatever dream that we talked about at your table, write it down. It really works. And all you have to do is just step off the curb. So, you know, during this 6 years of sailing around the world, we took over 8,000 photos. So we better get started. I'm not who you think I am. Some of these photos may make me look like a big adventurer. Well, maybe not these. But I'm not Sir Edmund Hillary. I'm not Ernest Shackleton, hell-bent on challenging the elements, you know, raging my fist at the storm. I didn't really want to be caught in that Red Sea storm. But in that sense, I'm not a whole lot different than a lot of you. I'm just a guy who wanted to go sailing. I became an adventurer by default. Out there, you either become brave or you turn around. By the way, if you don't think that going into the Panama Canal at night is scary, think again. As the guide says, move closer to the ship, and the propeller is the size of this room that you're approaching. Or that sitting up all night in a cold storm in the Red Sea is fun. So I was unprepared, but I went anyway. I had never navigated a boat across an ocean, and the first ocean we crossed was 3,000 miles of the Pacific, and we found the island. But it was a decision that was made from passion. For me, passion trumps fear every time. So I knew there would be risks. I knew I was scared, and I knew I was going to be scared a lot. But I had made the decision. You know, it's funny when you make a decision, a big decision, you expect there to be some sort of a fanfare, some sort of trumpets blaring, you know, or something. And like there should be a marching band that should have gone by when we sailed off across the Pacific Ocean. There was, but I was the only one who could hear it because it was playing in my head. But there is no marching band, and there's no fanfare. When you make a decision, you just make the decision, and then you go. We lifted the anchor, and we went. So I challenge you to ask yourself if you're letting circumstances decide for you, or are you waiting for your marching band, or are you going to just actually lift the anchor and go, or step off the curb? Everybody in here has a life that is a big adventure. Your life is a very big adventure. You don't have to go all the way around the world to have an adventure. In fact, you don't have to go all the way around the world to find the happiness that you might be seeking that's inside of you. I already did that. And actually, maybe I've saved you the trip. See the advantages of coming to the inside edge. I just saved you an entire trip around the world. But I traveled for 6 years around the world looking for something that when I came back, I discovered was inside of me all along. I'll get back to that.